Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamualaikum, Namaskar, and a very good evening to all of you. I'd like to thank the Observer Research Foundation and the Ministry of External Affairs of India for inviting me to this, the third edition of the Raisina Dialogue. I'm delighted to be able to come back to speak at this dialogue that allows me to interact with high dignitaries, senior policymakers, security experts, eminent educationists, and practitioners from around the world. The theme selected for the third Raisina Dialogue, Managing Disruptive Transition, Ideas, Institutions, and Idioms, is indeed timely. Friends, we live in an increasingly complex and uncertain world where concepts of foreign policy and national security are shifting rapidly from an era of familiar predictability to an era of risks and instability. Profound geopolitical transformations have swept our societies and economies, challenging the post-World War international order. In his introduction to the book, The Rise and Fall of Great Powers, British historian Paul Kennedy observed that as the 20th century approached, the pace of technological change and uneven growth rates and inequalities in the international system have made all systems unstable and to some extent unpredictable. Thus, traditional political studies and security doctrines are fast becoming history as we embrace new concepts of virtual and augmented realities, security, and alliances. We have to admit that while a lot of institutions are gaining strength through application of new technology, the process is not always without shocks. The very concepts of nation-state and sovereignty are being increasingly challenged in an interconnected world. In this complex world, states' national security, foreign policy engagements, and stability for sustainable future are increasingly governed by a wide range of competing, often conflicting, global factors and forces. Increasingly, more and more non-state actors are getting involved in the intra-state conflicts and trans-boundary crimes, including international terrorism, proliferation of WMDs, trafficking in human beings, drugs, arms, and laundering of funds. These are changing national and collective security relations. In South Asia, like in many other regions, humanitarian issues such as the Rohingya refugee crisis, terrorism and extreme violence, climate change are disrupting life, stability, and livelihood. In this evolving global context, Bangladesh should approach its foreign policy imperatives in a way that fits to our national objectives. Considering our long experience in global peacekeeping, Bangladesh will continue to pursue its peace-centric and sustainable development focused approach in the international forum. On the domestic front, the people-centric development agenda will continue to take priority, which will be furthered by regional integration and connectivity. The major thrust of our future foreign policy priorities would be, first, deeper and broader engagement with developed countries. Second, maritime cooperation and blue economy. Third, regional integration and multimodal connectivity. Fourth, focusing on immediate neighbors. Fifth, effective partnership for economic interests. Sixth, realization of sustainable development goals. Seventh, promotion of justice, rule of law, and human rights. Eighth, maintaining lead role in peacekeeping and peace building. Distinguished participants, let me come back to the theme of Raisina Dialogue. While it is critical to manage disruptive transition, there is hardly a simple linear way to do so. And speaking of ideas and institutions for managing disruptive transitions, as a long-term practicing diplomat, I would like to focus on foreign relations as a tool and a platform. I will take relations with the closest neighbor and the most trusted partner, India, in my consideration. The birth of Bangladesh in South Asia was a major transformative event in the world. Despite strong opposition, Bangladesh as a new country, which was economically less advanced, achieved freedom as a nation on the premise of strong nationalism amid opposition of many powerful countries. The government of India and its people extended their wholehearted support to our liberation war, which we had fought at the clarion call of our father of the nation, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman. In the new Bangladesh, devastated infrastructure, disordered economy, less developed governance systems were post-transition challenges. Bangladesh's strong and friendly relations with India was a major factor for bringing stability and effectively addressing the disruptive forces in Bangladesh. Riding on the solid foundation of relations between Bangladesh and India, our father of the nation, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, in his speech at Kolkata on 6 February 1972, floated the concept of regional cooperation in South Asia. He said, quote, "As for us, we will be wanting to cooperate with all concerned for creating an area of peace in South Asia where we could live side by side as good neighbors and pursue constructive policies for the benefit of our people," unquote. In that line, under the leadership of the daughter of Bangabandhu, Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, Bangladesh continues to pursue regional cooperation and connectivity as a means to effectively minimize the impacts of the disruptive forces. Be it in BIMSTEC, BBIN, BCIM, SASEC, Bangladesh is vocal and proactive on regional cooperation in all its aspects as a force to ensure long-term peace, progress, and stability. Ladies and gentlemen, in 2017, the world witnessed one of the fastest growing human movements of the history as Myanmar orchestrated an unprecedented exodus of Rohingyas from its Rakhine state. Almost 700,000 desperate Rohingyas entered Bangladesh since 25th August 2017. The helpless Rohingyas faced worst forms of human rights violations owing to their religion and race, which was mentioned by UN High Commissioner for Human Rights as, quote, textbook example of ethnic cleansing, unquote. Bangladesh, as immediate neighbor, had to bear the burden of hosting altogether over 1 million forcibly displaced population in its territory. It is the policy of friendly and good neighborly relations with neighbors that guided us through this difficult time with our neighbor, Myanmar. The Rohingya influx from Myanmar to Bangladesh has soured our relations in the recent times. However, we remained steadfast in our foreign policy objective and continued our bilateral engagements with Myanmar. We hope to see the problem to be resolved permanently with sustainable return of the Rohingyas to Myanmar. Bangladesh and Myanmar recently discussed and finalized the text of the physical arrangement which will facilitate return of the Rohingyas from Bangladesh, guided by the earlier understanding and principles signed as arrangement on return of displaced persons from Rakhine State. The physical arrangement stipulates that repatriation would be completed preferably within 2 years from the commencement of repatriation. The government of Bangladesh would like to urge the international community to support rehabilitation efforts in the northern Rakhine state of Myanmar, where the Rohingyas came from. We would also like to request India and the international community to keep putting pressure on Myanmar authorities so that complete and sustainable repatriation of Rohingya refugees could be ensured. Ladies and gentlemen, the past, present, and future of Bangladesh are indeed interlinked, as Prime Minister Modi had said in Dhaka, pas pas sat sat. In the last 4 decades since Bangladesh's independence, our ties with India have flourished in depth and dimension, and today we are enjoying the best of relations. The present government of Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, since assuming office for the second time in January 2009, has taken landmark steps towards improving relations with India. Thanks to the extraordinary initiatives from both the governments of Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina, the long unresolved land boundary agreement has been implemented. Similarly, some of the major disruptive issues have been resolved peacefully. This has led to citizenship to about 51,000 stateless people from both sides of the border. We have also peacefully demarcated our maritime boundary in the Bay of Bengal. In the past 9 years, we have experienced remarkable progress in many areas, namely security, connectivity, development cooperation, cultural exchange, power, trade and commerce, defense exchange, and so on. The security cooperation, together with our collective fight against terrorism and violent extremism, continue to play an important role in achieving peace, stability, and security in the region and beyond. I'm sure in the process, we have avoided many potential disruptive events. On the particular question of terrorism, our position is firm and unequivocal. Prime Minister of Bangladesh, Sheikh Hasina, steadfastly maintained zero tolerance to terrorism in all its forms and manifestations. In line with this, concrete steps have been taken jointly to improve the security climate in the region. No terrorist outfit is allowed to operate from inside Bangladesh and jeopardize the security interests of our neighbors, including India. This commitment has been amply demonstrated in the last 9 years through our tough and decisive actions. Bangladesh and India have successfully put in place a very intensive security cooperation framework, including a three-tiered mechanism between two home ministries at minister level, secretary level, and joint secretary level consultations. These mechanisms cover border management, intelligence sharing on terrorist, insurgent groups, all transnational crimes, trafficking in human beings, and so on. Our two border guarding agencies also interact regularly. That is the Border Guard Bangladesh and Border Security Force. And the navies and the coast guards have their consultation mechanisms. Defense cooperation between the two countries is also growing. Our cooperation is not only limited to preventing disruption in the area of security, but also quite deep in economic, social, and cultural fields. I have already mentioned our common commitment to advance regional and international cooperation, including strengthening of BIMSTEC, which brings together Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, Thailand, BBIN, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, and BCIM, Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar. In pursuit of regional connectivity, present government has offered transit through Bangladesh to not only India, but also to Bhutan and Nepal. Power sector cooperation between Bangladesh and India is a reality now. The sub-regional hydropower cooperation involving Nepal and Bhutan is being pursued by Bangladesh for greater national and regional energy security. Ladies and gentlemen, high level of understanding and context among peoples can also play a vital role in securing our society and economy. To increase people-to-people contact, both our countries are working towards more bus and train services between the two countries. In 2017, more than 1.4 million people visited each other's countries. There are numerous training exchange programs for our civil servants, police, members of the judiciary, technical experts, and numerous other scholarships offered by India for our young, talented professionals. Many Indian students are also studying in our public and private institutions. There is always the scope to broaden partnership between the two countries. What is needed is the positive mindset. What is needed is the positive mindset of our peoples towards relations. Equally, we need to understand each other's concerns, risks, and vulnerabilities, as well as opportunities. As the closest neighbors, Bangladesh and India will continue to work together to establish a secure South Asia for the benefit of all its peoples. I thank you all for your attention.